Joining us now for a preview chat on GDP is Sir Percival Peña-Diaz. He is director at the Ateneo Center for Economic Research and Development. Professor, welcome to the show. Hi.
Hello. Good morning, Mimi, and to your viewers. Thank you for having me.
All right. So, Sir, your forecast is for 2023 Q4 to come in at 5.8, correct?
Yes, that's correct.
And then for the full year, your forecast is what for the full year of 2023?
Full year, it's 5.6. So our estimates are close to what you mentioned earlier.
Why do you think so? Why this estimate? You're somewhere in the middle of the pack. Because the rate goes from as low as 4.9% Q4 GDP from Moody's to as high as 6.5% from RCBC. You're in the middle, 5.8. Why 5.8? What do you see?
Well, from what we have in the third quarter, we could see many of us were surprised actually that we grew that fast. Okay, but there were indications that spending for Q4 were front loaded, so that was really the reason why government spending boosted Q3 GDP growth, and it ended up faster than most analysts expected. Mm-hmm. But of course, you know, you might run the risk of exhausting your ammunition, okay? And that is what really we were expecting for Q4, that for you to be able to reach the target, you'd have to grow 7% in Q4. Mm-hmm. And it might be a tall order really. Mm-hmm. for us to reach that,
which is surprising, sir, because Q4, even if government spending was front loaded in Q3, did consumer spending during the holiday shopping season, was that not enough to make up for the slack?
Well, there have also been indications that household consumption spending has also slowed down. And of course, we're also still contending with, although it's slowing down, but it's still elevated inflation. So we cannot really rely on that source, which is 73% of GDP growth. But there are indications that it would slow down, and we'd have to have really other sources also from investment and also exports.
All right.
But 7% is quite a tall order.
7%, quite a tall order. Sir, just going back to basics, you did say we cannot depend on just consumer spending. So let's go back to basics. Econ 101, GDP is equals to consumption plus investment plus government spending plus net exports. That's exports minus imports. So where what can we depend on? I mean, government spending, you don't expect it to have delivered because it's front-loaded in Q3. Yeah. You're saying consumption, you're seeing indications of slowing consumption. What about in the investment and the export side? Could those provide a much-needed boost?
Yes, of course. We really need to do a better job there, especially in investment. That is why perhaps the way our government has restructured, we already have a secretary that specializes in attracting investments on top of the usual economic managers. And also we need to get a boost from outside. FDI, we have been a traditional laggard in that, and our neighbors have done a far better job in attracting FDI, which they have managed also to channel into exports. That is why they are able to export more than we do. Okay? And that's pretty much what we also need to do. But that's on the spending side. We can also account for the production side of GDP, where we can see really some imbalances that need to be corrected. I think the year needs to be devoted to really pushing for structural reforms because there seems to be still an imbalance leaning towards services. And much of the services jobs that we have really are, you know, people are just getting by day to day, serving in these service sector jobs that really are low productivity, to be perfectly candid. Mm-hmm. But we need to, again, like what you mentioned, go back to basics. I think the NEDA secretary mentioned this also, that we need to do a better job, not just in infrastructure, but also in agriculture and manufacturing. Agriculture, we have a new DA secretary. His work is very much cut out for him this year. But we need to boost that because that will also have a spillover effect naturally on manufacturing, because agriculture serves as the natural source of inputs for manufacturing. Manufacturing, we need to revive that, boost that further, because that is high productivity. That's going to be a source of high productivity jobs. So these are things that we might need to consider when we get into 2024, rebalancing the economic activity towards these basic sectors, which would create the most benefits for the most number of people in the domestic economy through the widest network of economic linkages.
But clearly, these solutions you're putting forward, Sir, are long gestation projects. You can't achieve these structural reforms in a year. I mean, other countries like Vietnam, Malaysia, or Thailand built these industries over decades, but it's a start. Because I'm going back to an IMF estimate that was way back in November or December last year, and they were expecting, based on 2023 and 2024 growth forecasts, let me just share with you, for 2023, the expectation is the Philippines will continue to lead Southeast Asia as the fastest economy, followed by Indonesia, followed by, these are 5.3, below six, essentially, followed by Vietnam. But 2024, there will be a rotation, a shift, with Philippines and Vietnam very close, very closely tied, followed by Indonesia. We're still doing, I mean, if you look at the bigger scheme of things, we're still doing better than many of our peers, right? Why doesn't it feel like it when you talk to people on the ground?
You know, I like what you said, Mimi, that, you know, these are, this would take long, these structural reforms, you know? But we should have done those things 2, 3, 5 years ago, okay? And, you know, we're seeing indications, you know, that we can still grow briskly compared with our neighbors when it comes to growth. We cannot fall far behind from them. But again, I would mention this. This has been repeated ad nauseam, that growth ought to be more broad-based and inclusive. So I think that remains to be a challenge for us, okay? Because the sources of growth, our economic engine, is really just relying on a very few sectors. It has been long described, you know, as narrow, shallow, and hollow. So I think I've been studying, even back in college, I've been hearing those adjectives. Okay, for us to, you know, sustain that, okay, we really have to, you know, for one thing, get back to basics, attract investments to those critical sectors of agriculture and manufacturing, if we can. That is why perhaps we already have a secretary whose job precisely is to do that, because the benefits of growth have not really, you know, trickled down to the average Filipino. That's why you mentioned we're not really feeling that. Only a few sectors are really reaping the growth, the benefits of growth. Okay, so, you know, there is this saying, if you are perhaps into running, if I were to use an analogy, okay, are you really more concerned about doing a sprint, outrunning all of your neighbors, or would you want to win the marathon? Because long-term sustainability is going to be important. You'd have enough gas to be able to reach your target. Uh-huh. And by that target, I'm referring to Ambition 2040. We have that. No? By 2040, which is what? Not just 16 years from now. We want to be a prosperous middle-class economy. We want to graduate to high middle-income country. Okay, but there will be, of course, trade-offs. Because if you want to restructure your engine, mm-hmm. as it were, you'll have to trade off something. No?
And what is the trade-off? What is the big trade-off?
If you want to go far, slow down. If you want the laggards to catch up, lagging sectors, you'll have to slow down. No?
Which one because, do you slow down? The services?
Yes, the services probably. But there are lagging sectors, no? Like what I mentioned, no? Agriculture, manufacturing. Mm-hmm. Okay, this does not mean to say, no, that you neglect them. These are still important sectors in services. But if we are to, you know, economics is about scarcity. You'll have to allocate resources, investments. You'll have to probably attract more to those things.
Mm-hmm. All right.
And
sir, just very quickly, you did mention, you know, you don't want to win a sprint. You want to win the marathon. And the marathon
is long-term.
Long-term, yeah. That the Philippines achieves, and this is our goal, upper middle income status by 2025. That is next year.
Next year.
Based on World Bank numbers, we're currently classified as lower middle income country with gross national income per capita of $3,950 per capita as of 2022. To hit upper middle income country, we'd need to see that $3,950 go up to $4,500. At the rate that we're moving, this engine is moving in its current structure, do you think we can hit the goal of entering upper middle income status by 2025, assuming that the goalposts will not move, of course, because the World Bank moves these goalposts from time to time?
Well, there is what we would call a natural trend path of growth. If we go by the real business cycle model, you know, economists talk about this. But if you leave it as business as usual, our economy would possibly grow by our estimates around 6%, 6.3%. Okay? Mm-hmm. Just letting things be. Okay? But of course, we need to grow faster. That's why the NEDA Secretary, Secretary Balisacan, mentioned that we have to target something higher, 6.5 to 7.5. Okay? Mm-hmm. So, you know, if we just let things be, we won't be able to hit 6.5 to 7.5.
Okay.
So it's again, quite a tall order. But, you know,
we gotta start somewhere, right?
Yes. We should have started long ago.
Okay? Unfortunately,
we have been saying that since, you know, God knows when, ano, but we have to consider really mm-hmm. rebalancing, restructuring.
All right.
But it will come at a cost, no, of slower growth, but we let the laggards catch up. And what you have been saying, that the average Filipino will feel it, I think that is what we would want, considering that we have a grand vision for this country, as articulated in Ambition.
Mm-hmm. And what perfect timing, because Ambition 2040 is actually the brainchild of Mr. Balisacan himself, who is now at the helm of NEDA. So hopefully he can see it through. Just very quickly, one more. So if you think that we're going to fall short of government's 6 to 7% full year 2023 growth, what will that do to the BSP? Because the BSP will meet on February 15th, a day after Valentine's Day. Do you think this could force the hand of the central bank to be more aggressive, whether it's on a hawkish side or dovish side? What are you expecting from the BSP? Or are you, like most other analysts we talk to, do you think that the BSP is just essentially going to be mirroring what the Federal Reserve does in the U.S.?
The primary mandate of the central bank is inflation. Mm-hmm. So if there are indications that inflation is going to ease up, and I think you mentioned earlier that the US might ease up on it, there are also positive growth developments elsewhere, like in China. So there might be less pressure for our own central bank to mirror what others are doing, which should have adverse inflationary effects on this, on our economy. So that is their mandate, inflation, to keep inflation under check.
So your, to ask, your crystal ball, just about, quickly, sir, because we don't have much time, what are you expecting from the central bank this year? Are you expecting 75 bips cuts, 100 bips cuts, and by when?
Well, given these indications that the U.S. economy is doing better and might ease up, they probably will at some point cut it by 50 to 75.
All right.
50. But that's just my educated guess.
All right. All right. On that note, Sir, thank you so much for joining us. It was a pleasure speaking with you and talking about, you know, the longer term structural reforms needed to win this marathon. Thank you, sir, for joining us. Have a great week ahead.
Thank you very much, Mimi.